Okay, yeah, so now we are going to do something far more interesting, right? So as you can see, I have this fish dude here. So what we want to do in this tutorial is create the animation, right? That's gonna happen from within the material. So just to save some time, I have my setup already there. I have this default material that already holds the textures that we will be using, right? We have this diffuse, we have this normal, and then we have this roughness, right? So I guess before starting, let me just explain how this thing is gonna work, right? So to create that animation, we need to generate three types of movement, right? Where the first one, it's gonna be a lateral movement, right? That goes from left to right in the y-axis, right? Like so. Second one is gonna be a rotational movement that basically will rotate my mesh from the pivot, like so. And then the last movement is gonna be a little bit more complicated, right? We want to deform the body of this fish using a sine wave, right? So for now, let's just focus to understand how we can create the lateral movement, right? So now let's go back to the material. We can start with this, right? So to create that animation and that lateral movement, what we can use is the trigonometric functions, all right? Something like the sine or the cosine function. It really doesn't matter at this point, you will see why. And I guess let me just explain how this thing works. I guess if you remember, right, from school, I guess when you were a little cub, a sine and a cosine function are basically the relationship, right, that you have between a given angle and the size of a triangle, right? So I guess let me just draw, it's gonna be easier to understand, all right? So let's say here you have a Cartesian plane, right? And then you have a circle. Well, kind of circle. Here we assume that this circle is normalized, so the radius of this one is gonna be one, right? And then here you have an angle, can be whatever, some random angle. That will generate a triangle, right? Like so, right? Where the length of this hypotenuse is gonna be one, right? That's the radius of the circle. And then for example here, whenever you ask for the sine of this angle, right, that will give you back the length of this dude right here, right? And when you ask for the cosine of this angle, that will give you the opposite, right? The length of this dude right here. So that's basically how it works, these two trigonometric functions, right? And we can take advantage of that to create the movement, the animation, right? So for that, let's say, then instead of inputting something static like an angle here, what we can do is input time, right? So time goes always forward, right? Meaning that it will generate all this trouble, right? That will generate triangles all the way up. Oops, not there, all the way around, right? So for the movement, all right, let's say that whenever you are at this point, all right, the length of this dude is gonna be one, right? And whenever you are in the negative range, all right, the length of this dude, this time, is gonna be minus one, right? That's basically how it works. Remember that when you input something that is bigger than the 360 degrees of a circle, right? That's gonna give you a repetition, right? That's true for conventional maths and for, I guess, any programming language, right? In the case of the material editor, we have a small difference. The sine and cosine functions are prepared to receive normalized values, right? Just a quick note, if you input, let's say 0.9, that's gonna be almost the full revolution, so maybe something like this. And when you input something that is bigger than one, right, here, that's gonna give you the next repetition, right? That's the only difference we have. So now let's see this thing in action, right? So let me create a time node here, right? This time node basically gives you the time in seconds, right? Meaning that every second is gonna do a revolution, right? So let me connect this thing here. Oop, that's too far, all right? And just for now, I guess we can visualize this value. So let me use one of the debugging functions. I'm gonna print this number. I'm gonna use the debug scalar values. Let me connect this thing here. And just for that, to visualize everything together, I'm gonna connect this thing into the missive. And I guess let me detach the opacity mask, right? So we can see this thing working. So yeah, basically here you will see that every second we have a value that goes from minus 1 to 1, right, all the time till eternity, right? So that's pretty cool. Something's happening there. Right, so that's pretty cool, and we can use that for the movement, right? So for example here, if I connect this thing directly, right, to the world position offset, we can add some offset to the normal position of my vertex, right? So in this case, this float one is going to be transformed to a float three, and that will work in the three axes at the same time, right? So right now we are offsetting 1 centimeter, so the movement right now it's very subtle, right? So maybe we want to add a control for that. So what we can do here is we can multiply this range, right, for something. So let me create a parameter here. I'm gonna call this thing lateral movement offset, right, like so. So let's say that this minus 1 to 1 range gets multiplied by 100, right, like so, right, means that this time you are going to displace your fish by 1 meter, right, 100 centimeters. There you go, right? So right now it's working in three axes. We don't want that, we only want the movement to happen in Y. All right, so before connecting that to the world position offset, what we can do is some, vector arithmetics, right, where we can multiply this float, right, by a vector 3, right? So this basically will multiply every component of this vector, right? So if you multiply this by 0 in red and 0 in blue, that will kill the movement, all right, in those axes. But if you multiply that result by 1 in green, right, basically you will mask the value to only happen in that channel, right, which is the green axis, right? So let me just compile and save so we can see this thing. And there you go, right? So now it's only working in that axis. And I guess that's too much for the movement, so let me play a little bit with this value. I'm gonna decrease maybe just to half. Yeah, 30 centimeters offset is okay. And before ending this tutorial, what I want to do is control the speed too, right? Right now we have like this constant value, right? So maybe we can add a control here to have a movement that goes a little bit faster or a little bit slower depending of in our needs, right? So for that, what we can do is simply multiply time by a factor 2. So let me create another parameter here. I'm gonna call this thing speed, right? And if you multiply the time by 1, obviously it's gonna be the same animation, right? The same speed for the animation. But if you multiply the time by 2, right, that means it's gonna be twice as fast. And if you multiply this by 0.5, it means that it's gonna be twice slower, right? So that's it. This is basically the end of this tutorial. In the next one, we will see how to create the rotational movement, right?